and a very warm word of welcome this evening to Clare Presbyterian Church in the name of our King and Saviour, the Lord Jesus Christ. If you're visiting this evening, and there are several visitors, you are especially welcome and warmest greetings to all engaging with the live stream and in time as well, listening on CD. Very special word of welcome this evening to the very Reverend Dr. John Finlay, who is this evening's guest preacher, and it is such a joy and an honour to have him with us this evening. At the outset, let me say thank you again to the musicians and singers, to those who have decorated the meeting house, and to everyone who has helped in any way in preparation for our harvest services, this of course being the third and final of those services. Thank you so much. We have gathered this evening in pursuit of our mission to magnify Christ by making disciples in Clare and beyond. Let us worship the triune God, and let us do so at his gracious call as we hear his word in Psalm 81, verses 8 to 10. Hear, O my people, while I admonish you. O Israel, if you would but listen to me, there shall be no strange god among you. You shall not bow down to a foreign god. I am the Lord your God, who brought you up out of the land of Egypt. Open your mouth wide, and I will fill it. What a promise. Open your mouth wide, and I will fill it. The God who gives good gifts satisfies his believing and repenting people, ultimately in the gift of himself to them, in the person of his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. So come, you thankful people, come, and let us stand as we sing to his praise.
Song of harvest home.
Well, we've responded to God's words in song. Let's continue to do so now in prayer. Let us pray together. Father, you are the Lord our God. And with the Son and the Holy Spirit, you live and reign as the one living and true God. The gods of the nations, the strange gods, the foreign gods, are worthless idols. But you made the heavens. You are the strong God who saves and satisfies. And we this evening, your believing and repenting people, adore you, for there is none like you. We confess, Father, that even as your people, however, we have bowed down to idols in our hearts and in our lives. We have not listened to your voice. We have not submitted to you in all things. Father, this is our sin. And we ask you now, for the sake of your dear Son, to forgive us. And so to win our hearts by your Holy Spirit, that we listen to you, even this evening, that we open our mouths wide and have them filled by you, to our joy and your glory, for Jesus' sake. Amen. Well, believing sinners, receive these words of comfort from God. In Isaiah 44, verse 22, he says, I have blotted out your transgressions like a cloud, and your sins like mist. Return to me, for I have redeemed you. And having confessed our sin, we have, if we are believing sinners, believing in the Lord Jesus Christ as King and Savior, we have this assurance of pardon. And to this we say, hallelujah and amen. Well, our New Testament reading this evening, our first reading, which will chime with what we will hear later from John, is 1 Timothy chapter 4, verses 1 to 5. And I've chosen this reading especially in light of the second half of it, although we'll read all five verses to set the very positive words in context. So 1 Timothy chapter 4, verses 1 to 5 on page 992 of the Pew Bibles. Let us listen to the Word of God. Now the Spirit expressly says that in later times some will depart from the faith by devoting themselves to deceitful spirits and teachings of demons, through the insincerity of liars whose consciences are seared, who forbid marriage and require abstinence from foods that God created to be received with thanksgiving by those who believe and know the truth. For everything created by God is good, and nothing is to be rejected if it is received with thanksgiving, for it is made holy by the word of God and prayer. Amen. So reads the word of God. Well, let's now continue our focus on the kindness of the God who loves to give good gifts. And ultimately the best gift in the giving of himself, as we listen to the song, The Wonder of It All. Let's continue to give thanks as we listen. Amen. And thank you so much, everyone, for reminding us of this truth that the wonder of wonders is that Jesus loves us. Now, before John comes to read and to preach God's word, and again, John, it is such a joy to have you tonight. Let's continue in praise as we sing together as a congregation the wonderful hymn, How Great Thou Art. And as we stand to sing, a collection for the Lord's work will be lifted.
Thank you. Thank you to Philip for his very kind and warm words of welcome this evening. It's a real pleasure to be with you at your Harvest Thanksgiving service here in Clare. And I've thoroughly enjoyed being with you, and especially the singing of the choir and the playing of the musicians. Before we turn to God's word, let's unite in prayer. Holy Spirit, shine thou on this book that we read, and gild its holy pages with the light that we need. Lord, your word is a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. And so we pray tonight that you would send out your light and your truth, and let them lead and guide us to your holy hill where your dwelling place is. And we say, speak, O Lord, as we come to you to receive the food of your holy word. Take the truth and plant it deep in us, and then shape and fashion us for your glory. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, our second reading is a harvest reading from Psalm 65. It's page 480. We're going to sing, or read rather, from verse 9 to the end of the psalm. 65 and verse 9. Where the psalmist says, you visit the earth and you water it. You greatly enrich it. The river of God is full of water. You provide their corn, for you have so prepared it. You water its furrows abundantly, settling its ridges, softening it with showers, and blessing its growth. You crown the year with your bounty. Your wagon trucks overflow with abundance. The pastures of the wilderness overflow. The hills gird themselves with joy. The meadows clothe themselves with floods. And the valleys deck themselves with corn. They shout and they sing together for joy. May God bless the truth of his word for his own name's sake. My text this evening at our Harvest Thanksgiving service is a verse from Thessalonians. This is what it says. Paul says, in everything give thanks, for this is the will of God for you in Christ. Or in all circumstances give thanks. It's so appropriate, relevant, that we come to our Harvest Thanksgiving service to bring to God our heartfelt thanks for our food and for yet another harvest. I know some of you, at least, I know will be in farming, and it's particularly relevant for you, and you're so grateful because it's your livelihood and you're so dependent upon it. Well, the truth is, for most of us, harvest maybe isn't quite as relevant as it used to be in past times, because most of our foodstuffs come from the supermarkets and it's there all the year round. But nevertheless, we are grateful for God's provision for us, even in economic times that are more difficult. We come together at this Harvest Thanksgiving service to say thank you to God for his provision for us. And I know that we live in a world that's largely skeptical of religious belief, and maybe might even find it simplistic for us to say and to sing, the food I eat, the clothes I wear are all bestowed by thee. But we, in our Christian faith, we know that God is the creator, and we have come to acknowledge his provision for us. And as we read together in Psalm 65, it's he who governs the rhythm of the seasons and the miracle of nature. And that's what we depend upon for harvest, and it's what we come together to give thanks for at this harvest time. But it's not just at harvest. It's particularly relevant and appropriate and necessary at harvest time. But it's not just harvest time. My text tells us more, doesn't it? In everything, give thanks. For this is the will of God for you in Christ. Paul writes to the Colossians, he says, whatever you do, in word or in deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father. It ought to be in our spiritual DNA to give thanks to God. Remember the story of the 10 lepers and how, if we can say it of the Lord, how disappointed he was at their ingratitude. Remember how he not only healed them, but he completely changed their lives. Because of their leprosy, they would have been distanced from family and friends, and their healing would have just totally changed their lives, brought them back into society and back to the norms of life and living again. Remember, there's only one who came back to say thank you. The Lord said, were there not 10 cleansed? Where are the 9? Has nobody returned to give thanks to God except this foreigner? I think sometimes we fail to come back to the Lord to give thanks. So much to give thanks for. Psalm 105, bless the Lord, O my soul. Forget not all his benefits. He forgives all your iniquities. Philip was reading earlier. Who heals all your diseases. And in this day when there's rightly such an emphasis on mental health, all your diseases. Who redeems your life from destruction. Who knows where we might have been if it had not been for the grace of God. Who crowns you with loving kindness and tender mercy. Who satisfies your mouth with good things. A God who forgives, who heals, who redeems, who crowns, who satisfies, ransomed, healed, restored, forgiven. Who like me his praise should sing? Were there not 10 cleansed? Where are the 9? In everything give thanks. You know, I think sometimes we're as spiritually negligent as sometimes our children are socially negligent, and we have to rebuke them and say, why didn't you say thank you? In everything. See, thanksgiving is part of our worship. I wouldn't maybe like to have to answer my own question, but I wonder if I had met you at the door this evening and said, why have you come tonight? Why have you come to church? Any Sunday morning or evening? Why have you come to church? What would you have said? Might you have said, I have come to give thanks? Psalm 95, let's come before him with thanksgiving. 100th Psalm, we're so familiar with that as Presbyterians. Enter his courts with thanksgiving and into his gates with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. I will give thanks to you in the great assembly. Colossians, sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs with gratitude in your hearts to God. Thanksgiving is, certainly ought to be, a very essential ingredient in our worship and in our praise. Look, the very atmosphere of heaven is one of thanksgiving. Glory, honor, and thanks to him who sits upon the throne. It ought to be part of our worship and praise. It certainly ought to be part of our worship and prayer. Because thanksgiving is a very essential part of prayer. It ought to be a key element in our praying. Don't we ever have noticed this before? Bear with me just for a second, because I want to illustrate this truth that we ought to be giving thanks in prayer from Paul's letters. Paul, when he was writing to the different churches to whom he was writing, well, he started as we would have started. He introduced himself, and it was a bit like saying, "Dear so-and-so," that's how we start a letter. Paul started in the usual formal way, and then, after the greetings, the very first thing that he invariably said or wrote was to give thanks for them in prayer. Just let me quickly read for a few of them. Romans, first of all, "I thank my God for you all as I constantly remember you in prayer." 1 Corinthians, "I always thank God for you." Ephesians, "I have not stopped giving thanks for you, remembering you all in prayer." Philippians, "I thank my God every time I remember you in all of my prayers." Colossians, "We always thank God when we pray for you." Thessalonians, "We always thank God for you all, mentioning you in our prayers." Timothy, "I thank God as night and day I constantly remember you in my prayers." It's like a chorus, it's like a refrain that runs through all his writings. It's as if he says, "Dear so-and-so, I thank God in my prayers for you." I think we could say that Paul didn't pray without thanksgiving. I'm sure you're a bit like me, and sometimes our prayers are a bit of a shopping list. We'll come to God with all our needs. Now, that's not wrong. We're encouraged so to do. But we're encouraged to do more. Thanksgiving ought to be a big part of our shopping list as well. Don't be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known. In our prayers, in our praying. But one particular thing I want to emphasize tonight, and it's in our text. In everything, give thanks. In all circumstances, give thanks. For this is the will of God for you in Christ. This is what God wants us to be. This is what God wants us to do. This is how God wants us to respond to every single eventuality in our lives as Christians. See, it's relatively easy. We may be forgetful, but it's relatively easy to give thanks to God when all's going well. Not so easy when life turns sour. When things are difficult and challenging. But even then, maybe I should say, especially then, we need to be thankful. For, as my text says, this is the will of God for you in Christ. This is how we're to respond in times of adversity. Let me give you a couple of biblical illustrations. Remember the story of the feeding of the 5,000? The disciples didn't have enough food. And they just said, "Look, Lord, send them away. We've got 5 loaves and 2 fishes, but what is that among so many?" Their resources were, humanly speaking, entirely inadequate. And the Bible says this: Jesus took what had been given him to him, the 5 loaves and the 2 fishes, and looking up to heaven, give thanks. The disciples were more preoccupied with the problem and what they didn't have. Jesus took that which he had been given and he gave thanks. He gave thanks for what he did have and he gave thanks for what he knew God could do. I know things can be economically difficult for us in these days. But let's be a thankful people. Come, ye thankful people, come for what we do have. for we're an awful lot better off than many others throughout the world. But even in our spiritual work, the Lord challenged the disciples, look, you give them to eat, you minister to them, and said, Lord, we can't. Our resources are totally and wholly inadequate. And even when we think we don't have enough, when our resources are inadequate, when we are overwhelmed by the spiritual need around us, and the temptation is to say, Lord, send them away. We can't cope with this. Let's look up to heaven and give thanks. Because he is able to do immeasurably more than we could ever ask or think. When we have exhausted our store of endurance, when our strength has failed, or the day is half done, when we reach the end of our hoarded resources, our Father's full giving has only begun. His love has no limit. His grace has no measure. His power, no boundary known unto men, for out of his infinite riches in Jesus, he giveth and giveth and giveth again. Let's give thanks for what we do have. Someone said, when the outlook is dark, try the uplook. And you know, sometimes the outlook is dark. Paul says, in all circumstances, give thanks. When God's way and will is through the difficulty, rather than skirting around it, give thanks. Remember the story of Paul and the shipwreck? He says, we had given up all hope of being saved. And the Lord revealed to him, the angel of God, whose I am and whom I serve, stood beside me and said, don't be afraid, Paul. But there was going to be a shipwreck. They were going to lose everything that they had apart from their lives. What did Paul do? He got them all together, even the unbelieving among them, and he gave thanks to God in front of them all. In everything, give thanks. When God's way is through the difficult, through the dark times, through the challenges that sometimes we face, through the tunnel when we can't see the light at the other end. In everything, give thanks. Not necessarily for everything, but in everything. I'm always encouraged by the wonderful story of Daniel and one particular aspect of it. Remember how Daniel was in Babylon was promoted to the top job. That aroused the jealousy and the antagonism of some of his peers, and he became the victim of their treachery and their injustice, and he lost his job and he was about to lose his life because of his faith in God. And then we read these wonderful words. It says, when Daniel knew that the writing was signed, and he was heading for the lion's den, when he knew that the writing was signed, what did he do? He went home to his upstairs room, and three times a day he got down on his knees and he prayed, giving thanks to God. Just as he had done before time. You're almost tempted to say, I wonder what he was giving thanks for. When he knew the writing was signed, he went up to his upstairs room, as he always did, and three times a day he got down on his knees, and he gave thanks to God. Oh, we know he was delivered. He didn't know that. It's easy to give thanks when we're delivered from the lion's den. It's a very different story to give thanks when we're delivered into the lion's den. Anybody can give thanks when we come out. It's a very different story, not so easy to give thanks before we go in. Sometimes when we cry out as the Savior did, my God, why? When he knew the writing was signed, he got down on his knees and he gave thanks. In all circumstances, give thanks. And maybe the most striking example of all, and with this I'll finish. Remember the Lord Jesus? We come together every time we come to the Lord's Supper and we repeat these words. The night that Jesus was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it. He took the cup, he gave thanks, he took bread, and he gave thanks. The symbols that spoke of his suffering, of his pain, of his humiliation, of his betrayal, of everything that might go wrong, would go wrong. Of his agony of spirit, my God, why, if it's possible, let this cup pass from me. With strong crying and tears, he prayed to the one who could deliver him. In that agony of spirit, knowing that all his friends had forsaken him, knowing that he'd been betrayed, that he'd been let down, knowing that the whole burden of the sin of the world was going to be laid upon his shoulders, in that darkest hour and in that lowliest moment, in the greatest crisis of life, he took the very thing that spoke of his suffering, and it says he gave thanks. In the darkest moment, when it seems the devil has won, when all things seem against us to drive us to despair, in everything, give thanks. For this is the will of God in Christ concerning you. Oh yes, we will emerge triumphant. We'll come out on the other side. Remember the story of the three Hebrews. Our God is able to deliver us, but if not, will not bow down. In everything give thanks, for this is the will of God for you in Christ. Remember how Paul said, look, don't be anxious about anything. Whether it's material, spiritual, in your personal life, in the work of God, don't be anxious about anything. But in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God, and then the peace of God that rises above, that surpasses human understanding, will garrison your minds and hearts in Jesus Christ your Lord. Thanksgiving is what renews and restores our spiritual equilibrium. Don't be anxious. In everything give thanks, for this is the will of God concerning you. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you this evening for all your love and your goodness. Thank you for the challenge and the help and the encouragement of your word. Lord, help us to be grateful and thankful. And Lord, help us not only to be merely concerned about ourselves, but concerned about others. We pray tonight for others. We pray for our nation, for our government, for our new prime minister. We pray for government nationally and locally. And we pray, Father, that they might be given wisdom and direction as to how to lead this people. We pray that they might rise above mere party politics and govern for the good of all. We pray for our own congregation. We pray for our own wider church. We pray for our moderator. Pray for our church as they meet in council this incoming week. We pray for those who minister to you in other parts, especially the Cochranes, we remember, in Portugal tonight. Bless them and their work and their ministry and their groups. We pray for those who have come to our land and to our college in order to better and further their gifting and their work, and we pray that you would bless them. We ask, Lord, that you would continue to be with us, and as a congregation, not just simply at our harvest thanksgiving time, but in everything and at all times. May we be a grateful and a thankful people. For we pray it in your name. Amen. Now we're going to conclude our service as we sing together for the fruits of his creation. Thanks be to God. Father, now we pray that your grace, your mercy, and your peace might come to rest upon us and remain with us tonight and always. Amen.